Bhagavad Lila, 10th canto, chapter 29. This is the beginning of the Rasa Panchadhyaya, five chapters describing Sri Krishna's Rasa dance with the beloved damsels of Braj. Sri Krishna is Bhagavan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishnastu Bhagavan Swayam, the Sarvavatari, the source of all the avatars and the source of all creation, Aham Sarvasya Prabhavo, and the cause of all causes, Sarva Karana Karanam. Yet, when he saw the autumn nights of Braj and felt the cool breezes scented with jasmine flowers, his mind began to think of loving affairs. And then he engaged his yogamaya potency. Sri Krishna is up to come. He has no desires to fulfill. He is full in himself. He has no desires. And he's Atmaram. He is self-satisfied and blissful within himself. After lifting Govardhan Hill, when Krishna was 7 years old, at the age of eight, on Sharat Purnima, the full moon night of Ashwin Maina, this is September, October, the full moon was rising in the sky over Vrindavan, and the horizon was tinted with a beautiful reddish hue. The orb of the moon looked like the face, the beautiful round face of a beloved wife, decorated with reddish kunkum on her cheeks to greet his husband, to greet her husband after he has been gone a long time. As the moon rose, the night-blooming lotuses, the kumudi, blossomed in response, and the forest was illuminated by the rays of the full moon. When Krishna saw the Purnima of the Sharad season, he remembered the gopis who 1 year previously had prayed to Goddess Katyayani. Katyayani Mahamaye Mahayogin Yadishvari Nandagopam Sutam Devi Patime Kurute Namaha. They prayed that the son of Nanda, Nanda Nandan, would become their husbands. So Krishna stole their clothes, Gopi Vastra Harana, and now it was a year later, and he thought that this is the perfect time to dance with these kanyas and fulfill their desire to have him as their husband. Shyam began to sweetly play his murali, attracting the minds of the beautiful gopis. When the Brajaramanis heard the sound of Shyam's murali, their romantic feelings arose and their minds became captivated. Then the damsels of Brajabhumi ran to the place where Krishna was standing at Vamshivat under the banyan tree along the Yamuna. Each gopi was unaware of the other's movements, and as they ran along the footpath for Abhisar, their earrings were swinging back and forth. When Krishna vibrated his flute that evening, many gopis were engaged in different domestic activities. Some gopis were milking cows, but they dropped everything when they heard Krishna's flute. Some gopis left milk boiling on the stove or cakes burning in the oven. Others were getting dressed, giving milk to the infant sons of their sisters. And some were rendering some service to their husbands. But the gopis stopped all these activities and ran to meet Krishna. Some gopis were eating their evening meals or having a bath or applying cosmetics. But they stopped all these activities at once. Even though their clothes and ornaments were in disarray, they rushed out of the house to meet Shyam Sundar. their husbands, fathers, let's say fathers-in-laws, brother-in-laws and other relatives tried to stop them. But Krishna had already stolen the hearts of the gopis, so they refused to turn back and return to their homes. Some gopis, however, could not get out of their houses, so they remained at home, closing their eyes, deeply meditating upon Krishna, pure love. In Ujjala Nilamani, Rupa Goswami Pad explains that there are two categories of nitya siddhas: those who have become perfect by sadhana of bhakti, they become sadhana siddha gopis. The sadhana siddha gopis are two categories, some that belong to a special group and those who do not. The special group are of two categories, two kinds: the Shrutacharis, who are gopis that were previously the personified Vedas, and the gopis who came from the sages who saw Ramachandra and Dandakaranya, the Dandakaranya sages or the Rishicharis. By no means were any of the gopis ordinary human beings. Some of the gopis are Devakanyas, daughters of the demigods, and they are partial expansions of the Nitya Siddha gopis. Kavi Karnapur Goswami explains that the sadhana siddha gopis that associated with the nitya siddha gopis became completely purified, and although they associated with their cowherd husbands by the power of yoga maya, they remained untouched by sexual contact, being situated in purely spiritual bodies. When Shyam played his murali, these gopis joined him, even though their husbands forbid them with sticks in their hands. Other gopis who did not have the association of nitya siddha gopis were not yet fully purified. By sexual union with their husbands, they gave birth to children. Later on, they also became fully purified and situated in spiritual bodies. But for the present, Yogamaya failed to help them, so they could not go to meet Krishna. The intense pain that these prohibited sakis felt in separation from Krishna burned away the remainder of their gunamayak covering. By meditating on Krishna, the Lord manifested himself to those sadhana siddha gopis, and they could embrace Krishna within their hearts. That transcendental ecstasy exhausted all of their accumulated material piety. In this way, the gopis immediately gave up their material bodies. To the degree that one advances in bhakti, the transcendental aspects of his body become prominent and the material aspects diminish. When one achieves prema, the material aspects of the body disappear and the body becomes completely spiritual. Nevertheless, to not disturb the false opinions of atheists and protect the secrecy of bhakti, Krishna usually has the mayak shakti exhibit the demise of a gross body of a perfected devotee. Thus, it could be that the gopis who were forbidden to join Krishna and locked within their rooms actually were seen to give up their material bodies, or they gave up the material aspects of their bodies and remained in their spiritual forms or siddhadehas. When the gopis arrived before Krishna, he officially welcomed them with teasing words which bewilder their minds. Oh, most fortunate ladies, welcome. What may I do to please you? Is everything well in Brudge? Please tell me the reason for your coming here. Of course, the damsels of Brudge had come to embrace Shyam, kiss Shyam, and dance with Shyam, so they were taken aback by Krishna's formal welcome, although they still smiled and listened eagerly. Seeing this, Krishna began to discourage the gopis by saying, "It is very frightening here at night in the forest. Don't you know? There are dangerous predators lurking in the darkness. Tigers, snakes, scorpions. Please return home, O Sumadhyama, girls with slender waists. This is not a proper place for women." As they listened to Krishna, the Braja damsels were still smiling, and Krishna continued, "Not finding you at home, your mothers-in-law's sons, brothers, and husbands are certainly searching for you. You should not cause anxiety for your family members." Upon hearing this free advice from Krishna, the gopis became disturbed and angry. Thus they diverted their attention to look at the beauty of the Vrindavan forest. Krishna took advantage of their inattention and continued to speak. Now that you've seen the beauty of the Vrindavan forest, which is full of flowers and illuminated brightly by the full moon, you can all return home. Do not delay, O chaste ladies. Serve your husbands and give milk to your crying babies. Perhaps you gopis have come here out of your great love for me. This is wonderful, because all living entities have such a natural attraction to me. Yet, the highest religious duty of a woman is to serve her husband, behave well towards her husband's family, take care of children. Women who desire a good destination in the next life should never abandon a husband who has not fallen from religious standards, even if he is obnoxious, unfortunate, old, unintelligent, sickly, or poor. For a woman from a respectable family, petty adulterous affairs are always condemned. They bar her from entrance to heaven, ruin her reputation, and bring her difficulty and fear. My dear gopis, transcendental love for me develops by the devotional processes of hearing and chanting about me, worshipping my deity form and meditating upon me. The same result is not achieved by mere physical proximity. There is no need to stand so close. Please go back to your homes. Krishna's discouraging words filled the gopis with sadness, their hopes frustrated. They were terribly anxious. Hanging down their heads, their sorrowful breathing dried up their reddened lips. The gopis scratched the ground with their toes. Tears flowed from their eyes. Those tears were mixed with the black cudgel, and they washed and they dripped on from down their faces and onto their breasts, and washed away the vermilion smeared on the top of their breasts. And the red vermilion and black cudgel fell to the ground in drops. The gopis stood silently, bearing a heavy burden of sadness, for their hearts were seriously wounded. Krishna was their beloved, and the Braja gopis had forsaken everything for his sake, yet he spoke to them unfavorably. Nevertheless, the damsels of Braj remained unflinching in their attachment to Krishna. The gopis did not want to retaliate with harsh words to rebuke Krishna, but still they wanted to. Stopping their crying and wiping the tears from their eyes, the gopis finally replied with agitated, faltering voices, "O all-powerful one, although you are completely independent, you should not speak in such a cruel way to souls that are surrendered to you. Do not reject us, who have renounced all material enjoyment, to render devotional service to your lotus feet. We agree with all that you have said about a woman's religious duties toward her husband, children, and relatives. However, this injunction is most perfectly carried out by rendering devotional service unto you, who are the dearmost friend of all embodied souls. You cannot accuse us of debauchery. Why? Because it is the natural inclination of all living entities to become attracted to you. Because you have once touched our breasts and stolen away our hearts, what use do we have now for our husbands, children, and relatives? Please grant us your mercy. O lotus-eyed one, do not cut down our long-cherished hope to have your association. Until today, our minds were absorbed in household affairs. But now you have stolen our minds, so we cannot even move even one step from your lotus feet. Therefore, how can we go back to Braj? What would we do there? Dear Krishna, please pour the nectar of your lips upon the fire within our hearts, a fire that was ignited by your smiling glances and the sweet song of your flute. If you do not, then we will give up our bodies in the fire of separation from you, and like yogis, attain your lotus feet by meditation. Even Lakshmi Devi, the unique position remaining on Lord's chest, desires the dust of your lotus feet. O vanquisher of distress, please be merciful, because to approach your lotus feet, we have abandoned our homes and families, having no other desire than to serve you. O jewel among men, please make us your maid servants. Seeing your face encircled by curling locks of hair, your cheeks beautified by Makara Kundala, your lips full of nectar, your smiling glance, your two imposing arms that take away our fear, and your chest, which is the only source of pleasure for the goddess of fortune, we must become your maidservants. Dear Krishna, what woman in the three worlds would not deviate from religious behavior when bewildered by the sweet, drawn-out melody of your murali? Clearly, you have appeared in this world to relieve the fear and distress of the Brijvasis. Oh, kindly place your lotus hand upon your maidservants' heads and burning breasts. If you think your hand will be burnt, rest assured that you will instead feel pleasure, just as a lotus flower enjoys the scorching heat of the sun. After hearing the gopis' despondent words, Shyam mercifully enjoyed with them by kissing and embracing the coward damsels of Braj. Although he is self-satisfied, in the midst of the gopis, Krishna appeared like a moon surrounded by stars. He made the gopis' faces blossom with joy with his affectionate glances, broad smile, and effulgent jasmine bud-like teeth. As the gopis sang Krishna's praises, Krishna sang in response. Shyam and the gopis wandered through the forest of Braj, came to the shore of the Yamuna, with the cooling sand and a lotus-scented breeze. While walking along the Yamuna, Krishna put his arms around the gopi and embraced her. He enhanced the gopi's desires by touching their hands, hair, thighs, belts, and breasts, and by playfully scratching them with his fingernails as well. By joking with them, pinching them, glancing at them, and laughing with them, this way Shyam enjoyed his leela. The gopis became proud for the special attention they received from the Lord, and each one thought that she was the best woman on earth. This was all arranged by Yogamaya. In Natya Shastra, the author Bharata Muni says, direct contact is not fully appreciated until separation has been experienced. Understanding this, Sri Krishna wanted to relieve the gopis of their pride and show them further mercy, so he immediately disappeared, showing one of his six bhagyas or opulences of tyag or vairagya, renunciation. Grantaraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Jai Jai Sri Radhe. Jai Jai Sri Radhe. Jai Jai Sri Radhe.